गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन।
गुड इवनिंग मैम। गुड इवनिंग
सर, अ लॉट ऑफ कॉम्प्लीमेंट्स आर कमिंग योर वे। आई एम गेटिंग सो मेनी मैसेजेस, रेव रिव्यूज, एंड द पेन यू आर टेकिंग, इट्स क्वाइट एविडेंट, इट्स वेरी एविडेंट, एंड योर एक्सप्लेनेशन इज वेरी गुड।
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. A lot of people are asking for your contact number. They are asking for your PPTs. So it's not prerogative.
I'll give you, because you'd asked me yesterday about PPTs on behalf of them. So I thought ki I'll give you, but on the last day, I'll give them.
Right.
Otherwise, right. Otherwise their passion will stop. If in between, I'll give them a PPT.
Yes, of course, sir.
Okay, I'll give, ma'am. I endorse your request.
And for everyone's information who have just joined, we have uploaded the first two sessions on YouTube. It's Khalsa College Patiala channel, and you all can see both the sessions over there now. And we will be uploading them regularly as the days pass by.
That's great.
Right. So, sir, I asked you to continue.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. And very good evening to one and all the inspiring and aspiring participants. So, well, can I come to know what we have discussed yesterday? May I know from the participants that what was the topic yesterday? Okay. Okay, so Amandeep, you mentioned that we did, that is questionnaire. Yeah, so we discussed about the detail, what is questionnaire and what are the essentials of developing a scale. And we also discussed the different types of levels of measurement, okay, scales of measurement. And also in the last, I also gave you hands-on experience to SPSS, right? So today we are going to start with a parametric test, okay? So let me first share the screen and then we will, of course, start with the parametric test. I hope my PPT is visible to you. Can somebody tell me that is the PPT visible? Visible,
yes.
All right. So very warm welcome to on the day three session on parametric tests. So we are going to discuss today, dear participants, that what is parametric test and why it is called parametric test and what are the tools, what are the techniques that are or tests that are available in the research in order to conduct the parametric test. So as a ritual, I would likely to discuss the lecture outcome of the session today. So the learning outcome that after this session, you will be able to understand the concept of one sample t-test. So I'm going to initiate my session today on one parametric test, that is one sample t-test. So we are going to discuss today one sample t-test. What is one sample t-test? Where do we use one sample t-test? Why do we use one sample t-test? And how do we use one sample t-test? And at the same time, we are going to do hands-on experience through SPSS software. And after this session, you will be able to generate SPSS sheet as per the requirement of one sample t-test. And at the same time, you will be able to execute one sample t-test with SPSS. Okay, so this is the outcome of the session today. So, well, now, let us recapitulate the topic that we did yesterday or day before yesterday. So please give me the answer of this question, that being an owner of car dealership, You want to examine the association between the choice of color by the customer while purchasing a car along with specific age group. Okay, you have the two categories, that is the choice of color by the customer while purchasing a car and along with the specific age group. And for this purpose, you record colors like gentle color, bright color, very different, and divide customers in young, middle age and elder. So can you please tell me that the variables which are used in the research are measured at which scale? Can you please tell me that whether it is a nominal scale, ordinal scale, interval scale, or is it the ratio scale? Yes, over to the participants. Please reply me that which of the scale is there in this particular research when a car dealer or car manufacturer is interested to examine the association between the choice of color by the customer while purchasing a car. Yes. Is it nominal, ordinal, interval, or ratio? Which scale is it? Yes. I'm not able to see the chat's reply. Let me. Okay, so it is somebody, Dr. Kuldeep Kumar, you mentioned it is ratio scale, and Kavita Malik, you mentioned nominal, Jyoti Das, nominal, and Jayanti Das, nominal, Harmandeep, very good. Yes, absolutely, you are absolutely right that it is a nominal scale. It is a nominal scale, of course, because here we have the categories of the car, okay, color of the car, choice of the color of the car by the customer. So that is why you must be agree with me that it is a nominal variable, nominal scale. Okay, now next, one more important question to recapitulate the topic. Imagine you conduct a research about examining the effect on CGPA of student from the hours spend on study on weekly basis. So which combination is correct in this research? Can you please tell me that you are going to study the examining the effect on CGPA of student and the hourly spend on studies by the student? So please, can you please tell me which of the option is the right answer, whether it is the CGPA, that is ratio, A option, R spend in duty ordinal, or these B option, CGPA interval, R spend in study ordinal, or CGPA is ratio and R spend in study is ratio, or CGPA is nominal or R spend in study is interval. Which of the combination is perfect, whether it is A, B, C, or D? Can you please write, tell me? Very good. Very good, Archana Nag. You are absolutely mentioned right that it is the C option. Fantastic. Fantastic. Yes, absolutely. That CGPA is a ratio data and R spend in study is also a ratio data. So the C option is absolutely the right answer. Very right. Very right. Wonderful. Those faculties or those participants who have given the C option, I'm quite glad to see their performance, to see their answer. Okay. Now identify the type of questionnaire. Can you see, look at the type of question here. How much are you planning to spend in a fixed deposit scheme this year? Less than rupees 20,000, 40,000, 1 to 60,000, 60,000 to 80,000, 80,000, 1 to 1 lakh. And there is another question, for what time period will you be investing in a fixed deposit scheme, less than 1 year, 1 year to 2 year, 2 years to 3 year, 3 years to 4 year, and 4 years to 5 year. Can you please tell me the type of questionnaire it is? Is it a close-ended structured questionnaire, or is it open-ended or unstructured questionnaire, or both A and B, or neither A nor B? Very good. Very nice. Yes, Dr. Zakir Mohammed Hussain, Dr. Manju Mittal, absolutely. Dr. Pramod Sharma, all the senior participants. Absolutely right. Yes, of course, it is the close-ended and structured questionnaire, because here the questions are structured, okay? And moreover, the questions are close-ended. Options are there. Multiple choice options are there. So such type of questionnaire is called the close-ended and structured questionnaire. And open-ended questionnaires are generally used in the qualitative research, as I discussed earlier also, yesterday also, when you are going to, reveal, when you are going to do a study in depth. I think, a qualitative research is just like a peeling an onion. Okay, you carry on peeling an onion. So what is there? The outer layer of onion is very bitter. Okay, it brings tears to your eyes. But inside the onion, it is very sweet. Okay, the inside bud of the onion is very sweet. I think you must be agree with me also that the layer by layer you start, peeling off the onion, it becomes sweet as you go inside. So that's what sometimes we call it as a qualitative research, when you are going to study in depth study. And in that particular type of study, you use open-ended and unstructured question. Though you do not use your unstructured questionnaire, because questions should always be structured. But of course, the questions are into a open-ended ones. All right. Now I'm going to show you one questionnaire, where you can see that this questionnaire is based on the UTAT model. UTAT means the model which is given by the Venkateshwar. It is one of the prominent model which is applied by the researchers, which is used by the researchers in particularly in the technology adoption studies, like e-commerce adoption, internet banking, mobile banking. So these type of studies, we can go for the model, which is the model is called the UTAT model, UTAUT model. Okay, and you can see that sometime researcher use, what we can call it is the established questionnaire, which is already a standardized questionnaire. So whenever you are taking standardized questionnaire, like the questionnaire which has already been, validated and already been tested by the authors, like you have the UTAUT model, the base, the questionnaire, then you need not to go for any kind of validity of the questionnaire, because it is already established questionnaire. But when you are making your questionnaire at your own, then you need to check the face validity, content validity, construct validity, and the criterion validity. And there are other validities also, like discriminant validity, which we can check through when we are going to do a structure equation modeling. Like you have seen that these constructs are there, like performance expectance, effort expectance, social influence, perceived credibility. These are the constructs. So this is construct validity. Constructs are already being defined by using these number of items, these items, like these PE1, PE2, PE3, PE4. These are the items which denotes these, defines these construct performance expectancy. And these items have been taken from these resources like Lon and Lin, Venkatesh and Jang, and Foon and Fa in 2011. So this is an established questionnaire. So today we are going to discuss the hypothesis testing. So what is hypothesis? What is hypothesis? Generally, students mention that hypothesis is an assumption. Hypothesis means when it comes no in the null hypothesis, yes in the alternate hypothesis. These are generally, common answers if you ask from the researcher. But what is hypothesis? Hypothesis is a formal statement. Basically, it is a formal statement that presents the expected relationship between an independent variable and dependent variable. This definition is given by Creswell in 1994, that hypothesis is a formal statement. Okay, hypothesis is developed by the researcher based on the assumption about an unknown population parameter that can be studied and explored by taking a sample from the population, and from the sample take the decision to reject the hypothesis and to accept the hypothesis. So hypotheses are always formulated for the population. They are never formulated for the sample. Please note in your notebook or wherever you are jotting down. Okay. Hypotheses are always meant for the population. And decision makers means the researchers. They collect the sample data, okay? They collect the sample data by studying a sample of the total population and use these sample statistics. Sample statistics means that is called the sample mean, okay? Sample statistics to make an inference about the hypothesized population parameter. Please note down that there are two basic terminologies that are used in the hypothesis testing. One is the parameter and second one is the statistics. Statistics is always denotes to sample and parameter is always denotes to the population. Okay, please note down these two things. So I am showing you one model. Okay, in PhD level, what we do, we have a theoretical model. Okay, when we are going to conduct the study. Suppose, for example, if somebody is doing a study on online shopping adoption in Nigeria, okay, like one of my students who is Usman Mohammed, he is a faculty in Nigeria in one of the polytechnic college, and he is doing a study in the consumer acceptance and adoption in online shopping in Nigeria in Kano State, okay, Kano State in Nigeria. So he is using this model, UT-AUT model, because this model is fit and this model is quite suitable for the study, because this UT-AUT model is perfectly fine for conducting the study based related to the online shopping, online adoption, technology adoption. Dr. Venkatesh, who has developed this model. So earlier he gave the model TAM model, then this model is now been extended and now it is called the UT-AUT1, UT-AUT2. So this is our UT-AUT2 model, which is you can see on the slide also. So from the model, actually we generate the hypothesis. Hypotheses are always formulated from the model. Please note down always like these arrows. You must be watching that this performance expectancy is influencing intention. Effort expectancy is influencing intention. The arrows which are denoting towards the intention, it means these are hypotheses. H1, H2, H3, H4, H5, H6, H7. So there are seven hypotheses which you can derive from this model. Okay. So from the model, you derive hypotheses like you can see here. I have brought these hypotheses for you. Like the first one, this is the hypothesis that performance expectations significantly affects individual intention to use mobile banking. Similarly, effort expectation significantly affects individual intention to use mobile banking. So these are called hypotheses and these are called alternate hypotheses, or moreover, these are called directional hypotheses. Please note down such type of hypotheses which are based on the model. When you are taking the hypothesis from the model, okay, and these hypotheses signifies the direction, like positive or negative, positive direction or negative, positively influenced or negatively influenced. Like this is the directional hypothesis, like performance expectancy significantly affects individual intention to use mobile banking. Similarly, facilitating conditions significantly affect individual behavior of using mobile banking. So one thing is very clear. Generally, researchers, they use two type of important hypothesis. Please note, you already may be knowing. One is null hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, anti-directional hypothesis. the advanced studies, like you, when you are guiding a research scholar or when you are doing a PhD thesis. So I would recommend you to go for directional hypothesis. Directional hypothesis, when the review of literature already exists. When the review of literature do not exist, then you can go for the null hypothesis or the alternate hypothesis. Otherwise, you can go for the directional hypothesis, which you have taken from the review of literature and based on the, you know, model. Okay, whatever the model you are using, your conceptual model or the theoretical model. Okay, this is theoretical model. And you can also frame your own conceptual model. So based on the conceptual model, you will write the hypothesis. So what is hypothesis? So one thing is clear, that hypothesis is a formal statement. It is a formal statement that that present the expected relationship between independent and dependent variable. What is independent variable here is performance expectancy is the independent variable, and individual intention to buy is a dependent variable. So you are showing the relationship, okay, in the formal statement, that is called the hypothesis. Okay. And this is called H1, H2, H3, H4. Okay. And then come to the, let me take any, see the chats also. Okay. I will make the PPT available. I will make the PPT available. Don't worry. Don't worry. Okay. I will make the PPT available. Now we are going to discuss about the hypothesis tests. What do you mean by hypothesis test? So first of all, note that we are going discussing today parametric test. So there are two types of hypothesis test. One is parametric test and another one is the non-parametric test. Parametric tests are always conducted on metric data. Please note down, it is always conducted on metric data. Parametric test cannot be performed on the non-metric data. If your data is non-metric, non-metric means your nominal data or ordinal data, then you have a non-parametric test like chi-square test, KS test, Runs test, binomial test, or in case of or you can also go for chi-square test, Mann-Whitney test, Wilcoxon rank test. These are given in this slide also. But today I am going to discuss with the parametric test only. Parametric tests are performed only on metric data. So today we are going to discuss in the next minutes, we are going to discuss the one sample t-test. First of all, this is a very inspiring slide, which I always appreciate my guru and my, you can say from always, I appreciate Professor Neeraj Kaushik. I have attended his workshops and I learned him a lot about the research methodology from him. And this is the, a ready reckoner. This is a ready reckoner for a researcher, that they can look at the variables, and with the variables, they are able to come to know that which tool and technique will be applied. For example, if your data is univariate. Univariate means that there is no two variables, only one variable is there. So you can go for, and that variable is metric, then you can go for mean, median, sigma, standard deviation, or one sample t-test. Okay, one sample t-test is applied when it is a univariate. Univariate means one variable, and that variable is metric. Metric means interval or ratio data. In that, if your variable is univariate and it is a metric data, then you can go for mean, median, standard deviation, and one sample t-test. But if your univariate is non-metric means gender, age, occupation, these are non-metric data, then you can go for count or percentage of frequency, as I already told you earlier also in my day before yesterday's lecture also. So here we are going to perform one sample t-test. So one thing is very clear, that one sample t-test is applied when your data is metric and you have a univariate variable is univariate. Now, please note down that t-test, f-test, and z-test, they are called parametric test. F-test means ANOVA. Z-test, z-test, which we call it z-test, and t-test, they are called parametric test. What is parametric test? Why it is called parametric test? It is called parametric test. Why? Because the parameters of, there are certain parameters which are actually important to call it as a parametric test. Means that the first parameter is that the population from which the sample have been withdrawn should be normally distributed. Okay, if your sample that which has been taken from the population or the population is not normally distributed, then you cannot apply the parametric test. Please note down, the first condition is normality. Assumption of normality should be met. Okay, that the population, the sampling distribution should be normally distributed. How can we ensure that the population is normally distributed? So we can check through a different ways. Number one is the in the statistics books, it is written that your bell-shaped curve, if your data, when it is plot, if it is in the shape of bell-shaped curve, then we call it as a normal distribution. Otherwise, we have the certain test which we can apply through which we can check the normality. Graphically, we can check the normality through QQ plot. Please note down, we perform the graphical method which is called the QQ plot. And the second way of checking the normality is KS test. Please note down, KS test. KS test is the test which we conduct through normality through statistical way, and the through graphically we can check through from the QQ plot. So I'll give you the demonstration definitely. And more importantly, the second condition for applying the parametric test is that the variables, the scale type should be interval or ratio. The scale type should be interval or ratio. Kabhi bhi गलती से भी नॉमिनल या ऑर्डिनल डेटा पे पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट मत लगा देना, वरना योर थीसिस, योर सिनॉप्सिस, योर विल बी रिजेक्टेड. ओके, सो पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट कंडीशन शुड बी मेट व्हेन यू आर गोइंग टू अप्लाई फॉर द पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट. एंड दीज आर टू इंपॉर्टेंट कंडीशंस. वन इज नॉर्मैलिटी, अजम्पशन ऑफ नॉर्मैलिटी. सेकेंड इज द मीट्रिक डेटा एंड नो सिग्निफिकेंट आउटलायर. The third important condition, please note down, which is missing in the slide, no significant outlier. You should clean the data, check the data, whether there should not be any extreme value in the data. Extreme value means, suppose, for example, if I tell you, calculate the mean of five students, the average weight of the student is, let's say, 50 kg, 60 kg, 70 kg and 80 kg. If I write 120 kg, obviously your average will be affected, your mean will be affected. But in case of median, there will be no effect, because in the median you are calculating the mid value. So that is why in the parametric test it is very important that you should please note that there should not be significant outliers. So three conditions are very, very important. And whenever there is a normality, your data, your normal distribution should be like a bell-shaped curve. It is a bell-shaped curve, and where mean, median, mod, they are here equal. And this is the parametric test procedure. So what is one sample t-test? Now the question arises, okay, what is one sample t-test? One sample t-test is the test where a researcher wants to determine whether sample belongs to a particular population. Simply means whether sample, any random sample which you have picked from the population, it contains specific mean for certain variable. For example, you are conducting a study on, say, for example, the satisfaction. Okay. And you picked up a sample of a student. Okay. And you would likely to take an example of one MBA class. And from the MBA class, you are going to compare the average CGPA of the student, average CGPA of the student with the population average, that is called population parameter. Okay, like for example, 8 CGPA or 7 CGPA, and I'm going to compare the average CGPA of the student with the 8 CGPA, which I am going to take as a hypothesized mean. and I'm going to compare this sample mean with the population mean. So here I'm going to apply the one sample t-test. Why? Because I have only one sample. I have only one class, one sample of students. But if I am dividing the sample into two categories, like boys and girls, say, for example, boys and girls. Now I have two distinct categories. Then I will go for the independent sample t-test. Is it clear to you? Please, first of all, this thing should be very, very clear to you that in the one sample t-test, the sample is one. One sample is there. But in case of independent sample, we have the two distinct categories. Like if I'm taking a one section of the student and comparing the average CGPA of the student with the, you know, hypothesized mean. Hypothesized means I'm taking as, let's say, 8 CGPA or 9 CGPA, and I'm comparing the CGPA of sample of the class with this hypothesized mean. Then I would go for one sample t-test. But if I am going to compare the difference between the male CGPA, the CGPA of the male students, and the CGPA of the female student, then it is called the, then we can go for the independent sample t-test. So one sample t-test first is used to whether the sample belongs to a particular population. Second, the population parameter. Population parameter means that is mu, that is mean average, is not always known to the researcher. Has the same, we can hypothesize. We just hypothesize. Just when I hypothesize, I have taken 8 CGPA or 9 CGPA. I am just taking as a hypothesized based on these certain assumptions. And now I am going to comparing the CGPA of these students with the hypothesized CGPA. And this hypothesized value is known as test value in SPSS software. While conducting the one sample t-test in the software, this hypothesized value is known as test value in the analysis of one sample t-test. So first of all, graphically, you can see here that this is your population, and you are randomly selecting the sample, and you are comparing the sample mean with the population mean. Okay, you are comparing the sample mean with the population mean. And statistically, the sample mean is written as x raised to power bar, which is called statistics. And the population mean is called the mu. Okay, in the statistical form, we write like this way. Okay, mu. So what are the assumptions? Assumptions are, I've just told you that your dependent variable should be interval or ratio level data, continuous data, that is called continuous, and no significant outlier. And dependent variables should be approximately normally, you know, distributed. Okay. So these are the three important assumptions of one sample t-test. So now what are the steps to execute one sample t-test? What should we do as a researcher? How can we perform the one sample t-test in SPSS? So first of all, as you are a researcher, you are supposed to data entry in SPSS, jaise humne kal kiya tha. Yesterday we have done the data entry in SPSS. Then you develop null and alternative hypothesis. Okay, you will develop null and alternative hypothesis. I will let you know what type of hypothesis you will generate in the one sample t-test. And then you will examine the assumptions. Examine the assumption means the three assumptions. The first assumption is normality. You might have written in your notebook also. One, first is the normality. Second is the outlier. There is no significant outlier. And third is that the data must be on the interval or the ratio data. And then we are going to interpretation of output. In the output, we are going to look for descriptive statistics and one sample test statistics. And we are going to take decision based on p-value. Okay, on the p-value, we are going to take the decisions. Now, for example, let me give you one small example so that you could understand the one sample t-test. There is a certain Bolt company, Bolt hota na, which the bolts, they are manufactured. Okay, like the bolts are used in car also, in our house also. So a certain bolt is designed to be 4 inches in length by the production department in a manufacturing unit. Okay, in one of the manufacturing unit, the production department designs the bolt, which is of 4 inches in length. A production manager randomly select 15 bolts from the main load and measured their length. So what production manager did, if the managers randomly select 15 bolts from the main lot and measured their length. The length of the random sample of 15 bolts are shown in the data file, which I will be likely to show you. And you are given that test at 5% level of significance, whether whole load are 4 inches in the length or not. So this is the example where we are going to perform the one sample t-test, because here you have the hypothesized mean, which is 4 inches, and you are going to compare the sample mean with the population mean. Please try to understand simply, when you are going to compare the sample mean with the population mean, here you are going to perform the one sample t-test. And even in the SPSS also, it is also written compare means. Okay, one sample t-test means compare means. T-test, the meaning of t-test is simply that you are going to compare the means. So here the production manager is going to compare the mean of average length of the bolt with the hypothesized mean, which is called the 4 inches, which is given that is 4 inches in length by the production department in a manufacturing unit. This is the hypothesized mean. Okay. Now, I have just taken these short screenshots for you so that you would be able to understand that what I'm going to perform in the SPSS also. So dear participants, the data entry which you are going to do is that you have given this length, like length of 4, 3.95, 4.01, 3.95, 4, 3.98, 3.9. These are the length of bolt, okay, given by the in the data. And these are 15 bolts, and these are the length of the bolts. Okay, the first bolt is 4 inches, second bolt is 3.95, third bolt is 4.01, and fourth bolt is 3.95, fifth is 4, sixth is 3.98, and seventh is 3.97. So this is the length which is given to you, the bolt size. Okay. Now, what you are going to do, you are supposed to create the null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. The very first step in the hypothesis testing is to create a null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. So the null hypothesis, statistically, we write H naught mu 1 is equal to mu 0. Mu 1 is population mean, and mu 0 is your hypothesized value, which is given that is 4 inches. Mu 0 here is 4 inches. I will let you show you in the next slide also. So H naught mu 1 is equal to, you know, mu 0, which means that population mean and hypothesized value are equal. Equal means that there is no significant difference. Equal means there is no significant difference. And whereas the alternate hypothesis is that HA mu 1 not equal to mu 0. Statistically, we write, please note, please remember it, that statistically we write null hypothesis like in this form, whereas the narrative form, in the statement form, we write like the hypothesis that population mean and hypothesized value are equal. Equal means no significant difference, and population mean and hypothesized value are not equal means no, it means the significant difference. No significant difference and significant difference. So here we are going to frame null and alternative hypothesis. When we are going to frame null and alternative hypothesis, the null hypothesis is the H naught is mu is equal to 4. And whereas the alternate hypothesis is that H1 mu is not equal to 4. It means that the bolt length mean is equal to 4 inches. That is a null hypothesis, which means no significant difference. And alternative hypothesis is not equal to 4, which means that the bolt mean length mean is not equal to 4 inches, which means that there is a significant difference. So you can write like this way also, that there is no significant difference, or there is significant difference, or you can also write like this way, the bolt length mean is equal to 4 inches, or the alternate hypothesis could be the bolt length mean is not equal to 4 inches. Now, once the null hypothesis. Yeah, it is there in the data view. I will show you, Rosie. Don't worry. Just let me complete. Then I will show you on the SPSS also the same process. Complete process I will show you. Don't worry. So here I am going to check first the normality. First, I am going to check the normality because as you know that without normality, if there is no normal distribution, we cannot go for one sample t-test. In order to check the normality, we will go to explore and analyze, explore. In the explore, we will write the dependent list. Dependent list means your interval data or ratio type of data, which is there. Like here we have given the length of the bolt. So that is the dependent list. And here, when clicking on the status plots, in the plots, we are going to click on the normality plot with test. Normality plot with test. These two options we are supposed to choose while checking for the normality of the data. Once it is done, then you will click on OK, and you will get the output like this way. I will show you, I will perform it also on SPSS, but I just put it on the slide so that once I will share the slides with you, you will be able to recall that what is the output and you are able to check that whether your output and this output is same or not. So you have one is descriptive. From the descriptive means, what is descriptive? Descriptive means mean, median, minimum, maximum, range, skewness and kurtosis. These values you get from the descriptive statistics. And here you can see through QQ plot. QQ plot means you are comparing the observed value with the expected value. When your observed value, okay, are very near to this line, okay, which is there at the length is there, which is very near to this line, then we can say that normality is there. But if these points, these data sets are far away from these line, far away from this line, then we can say, suppose one dot is here, one data point is here, one data point is here, one data point is here. It means that normality is not there. Otherwise also, you can also check through the test, which is called KS test. KS test means Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. Please note down Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, KS test. And the decision rule is that if the KS value means that significance value here is 0.20. Please note down when the P value is greater than 0.05. When P value in the case of normality, when P value is greater than 0.05, then it means normality is there. Okay, normality is there. But in case P value is less than 0.05, then there is no normality. But in this particular example, if you can see here, our significance value is 0.20. 0.20 means that the P value is greater than 0.05. Okay, at 5% level of significance. When it is greater than 0.05, then normality is there. The data is normally distributed. So you can see also, I have also created the null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis. Null means that population is normally distributed. In the case of normality, the null, please don't write Riddhi, please don't write on the screen, please. Don't put the marker on the screen. Okay, so population is normal distributed, and H1, the alternate hypothesis is that population is not normally distributed. So you can see here in this particular value, the KS value is 0.20. So you can write here the P value associated with KS1 sample is more than 0.05, that is P greater than 0.05 at 5% level of significance. Hence, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. So we fail to reject the null hypothesis because the value is greater than 0.05, which is, so we can say that the population is normally distributed. Population is normally distributed. So one thing, fundamental rule, you just write that go for KS test. And when the performing the KS test, if the significance value is greater than 0.05, then straight away you can take the decision that, okay, the data is normally distributed. Okay. And then what we are going to do is, once it is clear to you that the data is normally distributed, then we are going to perform the one sample t-test by going through analyze and click on compare means. In the compare means, there is option given to you in the drop down, one sample t-test. One sample t-test, click on one sample t-test and choose the test variable. Test variable, the variable univariate, the variable which you are going to check the to compare. So you are taking the length of the bolt. So you are taking the test variable length, and hypothesized value is 4 here, which is given in the question, which is given already there. The hypothesized value, that is test value, is 4. And then you can click on OK. Once you click on OK, you will get the output like this way. One sample statistics, where you will get the number of roads are 15, mean is 3.9893. Standard deviation is 0.02314. And you are also, at the same time, you will be getting the results of one sample test. And in the one sample test, you are going to report the result that the mean bolt length, that is the mean, is 3.9893. Standard deviation is 0.2314. And N is equal to 15 was not significantly different from the hypothesized value of 4 inches, that is T, degree of freedom 14, T is equal to minus 1.78, and P is equal to 0.096. Obviously, please note down the mantra that which I'm giving you. When P is low, reject the Ho. When P is low, reject the Ho. Ho means null hypothesis. And when you know that it is 0.09 means it is greater than 0.05. So here we are not going to reject the null hypothesis, rather we are going to accept the null hypothesis, and we are failing to reject the null hypothesis. And when we are failing to reject the null hypothesis, then obviously we will conclude that the lot mean length is 4 inches. That means that there is no significant difference. So we can see that the lot mean length of the bolt is 4 inches. So first of all, let me, eraser not working. Let me do it. Please don't write on the screen, because it creates a lot of then challenge for me. Just a moment. Okay, is it visible now? Is it visible, ma'am?
Sir, the screen sharing has started. Just give me a sec. Now it's visible.
It's visible, right? Please don't, please participants, please don't write in the here, please. So so this is we are talking about the one sample t-test. So I am going to give you one question. Like, I am sharing one question from you. Suppose, for example, there is one survey you have conducted among 20 university students to measure their satisfactions toward the newly opened online library in the campus. Okay, there is one question which I am sharing with you. So you are a researcher and you are going to conduct a survey among 20 university students to measure their satisfaction towards the newly opened online library in the campus. So there are three dimensions which are given to you in the survey on the 5-point Likert scale. And these are content, service quality, and timings about the library. And here you are going to perform the one sample t-test. So how will you do it? Okay, first of all, you need to have the data. Okay, obviously you need to require a data, that is the rating on a 5-point Likert scale. So I am sharing my SPSS with you. Please Just a moment. Wait a moment. Okay. I hope the screen is visible to you. Please tell me that is the screen visible? SPSS screen is visible to you?
Yes, sir.
Visible? Okay. So first of all, I am going to conduct the test which I have just completed the example, that is the length of the bolt, okay? So that you should be clear that what is there on the slides. Let me take the, yeah. Is it visible to you? Okay. Right. So this was the variable view, that is the length of the bolt. Okay. And I'm writing here the length of the bolt. So I'm just showing you that how to perform the one sample t-test. So here, what will you do? You will go to analyze. First, you are going to check the normality. Okay. Whenever you are going to perform the parametric test, first you will check the normality of the data. So how will you check the normality? Go to descriptive, note down the steps. Please note down the steps. These steps are important. Okay. You will get n number of questions, n number of things from the book. But one thing is very important, how to perform the test. That is very, very meaningful. So go to analyze, go to descriptive statistics and explore. In the explore, click on the length of the bolt as a dependent list. Dependent list means your target variable, your dependent variable, that is the length of the bolt. And click on plot. In the plot, you will click on, put a tick on the normality plot with test. Normality plots with test. Okay. Is it clear to you? Please just write down the in the chat that, okay, the steps you are jotting down. What after plot? Yes, I'll be okay. Again, please again look at, first you have done the data entry, then go to analyze. Again, I'm repeating the steps. Please again, I'm repeating the steps. First, I am checking the normality. Because you know that my first condition is met, that this data is in a ratio data. I'm okay with it. Okay. Then second is the, I have to check the normality. So go in the descriptive, then click on explore. In the explore, you are taking the length of the bolt in the dependent univariate, the univariate you are taking variable length of the bolt. Then click on bolt plot. And here you are going to choose the normality plot with test. Click on normality plot with test and then continue. Once you are putting continue, then do it okay. Once it is okay, so you are getting the output. Just a moment, the output is there. Now I am again showing you the output because I haven't shared the whole screen. So now I am showing you the output file. So I hope now you are able to see the output file, that this is the case processing summary. In the case processing summary, you are getting that there is no missing value. All 15 number of bolts are there. And this is descriptive. Descriptive means your mean statistics, median statistics, variance statistics, standard deviation statistics, minimum, maximum, okay, skewness, kurtosis, all these comes under the descriptive statistics. So you can also show this descriptives in your research paper. You can also show this descriptive in your capstone project, and you can also put it in your PhD project. And here you can see the test of normality. The test of normality, the KS value, which is there is 0.200. 0.200 means which is greater than 0.05. As I already mentioned you that when the P value is greater than 0.05, in case of normality, otherwise, you know, we always take the decision that when P is low, reject the whole. Okay. And in this also case, we are also, you know, what we are doing, our P value is high. That is P value is 0.20, which is greater than 0.05. So what we will do, we will accept the null hypothesis. And when we accept the null hypothesis in case of normality is that the data population is normally distributed. So here we can say that the data, the population is normally distributed. Once it is, once this condition is met, and even you can also see through QQ plot, you can see on the QQ plot also, the data points are on this, near to this line, observed values are near to this line. So we can also say that population, the data is normally distributed. So now we can perform, we can go back to our, once we can define that the data is normally distributed, then we can again go for the one sample t-test. So what we will do, we will again go to the data view, and in the data view, we will click on analyze. And in the analyze, we'll go to compare means. In the, please note down the step, analyze, compare means, and in the compare means, you will click on one sample t-test. It is written over there, one sample t-test, and just click on it, and you will click the test variable. Your test variable is the length of the bolt. Length of the bolt is your test variable, and your test value is 4. It is hypothesized value. Assumed value, assumed population parameter you are taking as a 4, which is already given you in the question. So test value is 4, which is also called hypothesized value. Please note down, test value is also called hypothesized value. Okay. Now you are going to, okay. Once it is done, and click on okay. Once you have done the okay, so you are going to get the output. Your output, I am just showing you because I have to stop the screen. And again, I have to show you the output. Yeah, exactly. Now you can see the output. The output of the t-test is one sample statistics. It is written over here that length of the bolt is 15. Mean is 3.9893. Standard deviation is 0.2314. And the one sample t-test is the result. The now you are the very important. Now you are going to, you know, what we can say is the report the findings. Report. How will you report it? The report, you will report that the findings, whatever the reporting the results. So you will report that as the p-value, as the p-value is more than, so what you will write here, as the p-value, if you look at the output, if as the p-value is more than 0.05, because it is 0.096. 0.096 means what? 0.096 means p value is greater than 0.05. And the mantra which I have given you that when p is low means when p is less than 0.05, you will reject the null hypothesis. When p is greater than 0.05, then what will you do is you will accept the null hypothesis, or you will say you fail to reject the null hypothesis. It is better to write like this way rather than writing the accepting the null hypothesis. So here it is 0.096. So 0.096 means as the p value is more than 0.05, hence we fail to reject the null hypothesis and conclude that there is no significant either you can write like this way, we can conclude that the lot mean length is, you know, 4 inches. Okay, 4 inches. Or we can say that there is no significant difference. There is no significant difference between the population mean and the sample mean. Population mean is the 4 inches, and the sample mean is also, which is not very much different from the population mean. So that is why here you are comparing the sample mean with the population mean. So that is why it is called the one sample t-test. So in the one sample t-test, what we are going to do, we are, first of all, we have one sample, and we are just comparing the sample mean with the population mean, that whether the sample belongs to a particular population. In another way, we can say that the researcher wants to determine whether a sample belongs to a particular population. Okay. And the population parameter, and generally it is not always known to the researcher. So we generally take unknown population parameter, which can be hypothesized, like a production manager in this case, in this example, has taken a hypothesized test value that is 4 inches. Okay. So this way you can perform the one sample t test. Now I am giving you a real one more example for you. Just a moment. I'll be taking one example for you. The example which I have just shown you about the library, that there is one library and you are going to conduct a survey. Suppose you are teaching RM and you are given a project to the student that go and do a survey to measure the satisfaction towards the newly opened online library, or towards the brand, or towards the DO brand, towards the, you know, car brand. You can take any example, okay? Any meaningful marketing example towards the newly opened online library in the campus. And your three dimensions are there. That is the coverage of the content, service quality, and timings. So now I am going to again sharing the data with you. Just a moment. Okay. So here I'm going to open one new file. This file is satisfaction. This file is satisfaction. Yeah. Suppose I have conducted one survey from the students to get the survey of online library. And the student has got the coverage content on the 1 to 5 rating scale, service quality on 1 to 5 rating scale about the library, and timings of the library from 1 to 5 rating scale. Okay. So first of all, I think this is very simple. You know how to do a data entry, which I have taught you yesterday also. When you have the interval type of data, you define the values. One means highly dissatisfied, two means dissatisfied, three means not sure, four means satisfied, five means highly satisfied. Okay. And similarly, service quality is also again the interval scale on highly dissatisfied, two dissatisfied, three not sure. Now, first of all, now you will do this question with me. I'm not going to teach you right now. First of all, tell me, can I apply one sample t-test here? First, tell me. Yes, over to you. Now, the next 30 minutes is yours time. Please tell me whether I can go for one sample t-test or no. Please tell me. Yes. So what I can check? What should I check, Ambika? Ambika, in one sample t-test, what should be my null hypothesis? Mera null hypothesis kya hoga yahan pe? What will be my null hypothesis? No, null hypothesis. Null hypothesis. That the students are not satisfied. The students are not satisfied from the library. Yes, there is no satisfaction level. Very good, Ambika. Very nice. There is no satisfaction level. That is your null hypothesis. And what will be your alternate hypothesis? That these students are highly satisfied. Okay. The students are not satisfied. This is null hypothesis. And the students are satisfied. Then it is a alternate hypothesis. Okay. So what we are going to do, we are going to go with the one sample t-test. So what we are supposed to do, first of all, what we should do in order to execute the one sample t-test, sabse pehle mujhe kya check karna padega? What should I check? First assumption. What is the first assumption? Check normality. Very interesting. Fantastic. Wonderful. Appreciate. So I will check the normality. Please tell me the process. Please, can somebody write in the process? Can somebody write the process? Where should I go? Go to analyze. And in the analyze, go to descriptive. In the descriptive, go to explore. Explore. Okay. And in the explore, what I'll do? What are my dependent list? All the three I am taking as a dependent list. Okay. Coverage of content, service quality, and timings. Okay. And then what I'll do? Plots. In the plot, I will check normality plot with test and click on continue. And then what I'll do? I'll do okay. Once I will do okay. So what is there? I'm again showing you the output. Very good. So this is the output. Yeah. So now you can see here, this is the case processing summary, coverage of content, 15 students are there and N is no missing value. And these are descriptives. And this is test of normality. In the test of normality, you can see here that the coverage of content, the KS value is 0.048. Okay. And service quality is 0.20. And timing is also 0.002. So in this particular, if you see the KS value, these two values are greater than 0.05. Okay, 0.05. Okay, so then we can say that the normality condition is met. Normality condition is met over there in the case of coverage of content and service quality. But in case of timings, it is 0.002. 0.002 means which is less than 0.05. So we can say that in the case of timings as a dependent variable, it is not normally distributed. Otherwise, these two variables are normally distributed. So we can go with the t-test, one sample t-test. So what we can do now, we are going to again go with the steps. So please tell me what will be the steps. The steps will be go to analyze. In the analyze, we will go to compare means. And in the compare means, we are going to click on one sample t-test. Click on one sample t-test. I am taking the test variables, all three variables. What is the test value? What is the test value? The test value, I will assume the test value. Like one means highly dissatisfied in this particular, if you look at the variable view, one means highly dissatisfied and two means dissatisfied, three means not sure, four means satisfied and five means highly satisfied. So I'll be taking one as a test value, one as a test value, as a null hypothesis that the students are not satisfied. Okay. So that is why I am taking the dissatisfied, highly dissatisfied. That is the test value one. Okay. And then I will click on okay. I will click on okay. Once I will click on okay. So you will be having the one sample t-test results. So I'll be showing you the output file now. Just a moment. Output file. Yes. Now you can see here the two outputs you have generated. One is one sample statistics, that is the coverage of content is mean 2.4667, service quality is 3.000 and timing is 3.40. Can you tell me that which of the, what we can say is the factor is very important in case of online library when we see the mean? The timing is more important, followed by service quality, followed by coverage of content, because the mean of timing is 3.40 and the mean of service quality is 3.0 and the mean of coverage of content is 2.4667. But if we look at the one sample test results says that your service quality, the p value is 0.000 in case of service quality, and in timings also 0.000, and in the coverage of content the p value is 0.003. So in this particular example, what we are getting, the thing is that the p value is less than 0.05. hence what we can say is that the null hypothesis, if p is less than 0.05, what will you say? Can you write in the chat box? When p is low, what do you do? reject the hope, reject the null hypothesis. And what is the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis was that the student is not satisfied. So tell me whether the student is satisfied in this particular example or not. Yes, absolutely. That the student is satisfied. The student is satisfied because alternate hypothesis is accepted. Okay, the student is satisfied from the, you know, what we can say is the from the library, online library. Suppose Parampreet, right now I am taking only the student. Suppose if I take the two type of students, like girls and boys, and then I'm going to compare their difference, whether girls are more satisfied or boys are more satisfied, then which test I would go for? Then I will go for independent sample t test. Please note down, independent sample t test will be applied when you have the two distinct categories. Then we will go for the independent sample t test. Yes, Rosie Zen, absolutely right. Kavita Malik, yes, absolutely, you are right. We will go for independent sample t-test. Okay. When you have a one sample and it is univariate, then you will go for the one sample. For example, you take an example of the satisfaction of the brand. Okay. Suppose I am going to conduct a survey in Mittal School of Business in LPU, and I am going to ask the student whether they are satisfied from the online classes of MSP. So I am taking one sample, but if I am comparing males and females, if I am comparing the girls and boys, okay, and then I am going to compare that whether girls are satisfied or boys are more satisfied or girls are not more satisfied, then what we can do is we can go for the independent sample t test. Gagan has mentioned, sir, in normality test p value of timing was less than 0.05. Yes, absolutely right, Gagan. But T is a very robust test. So in the two variables, we have the p value is greater than 0.05. So we can take we can go with the normality. So we will assume that the data is normally distributed, and we can proceed for the one sample T test. Okay, because our two variables that was more than 0.05. So I am writing in the chat box, please note down. I'm giving writing, if P is low, please note down. If P is low, reject the hope. Please write like this way. I make this rhyme scheme like this way. If P is low, reject the hope. If P is high, accept the hope. Okay, if P is low, P means P should be less than 0.05 at 5% level of significance, P value. Okay, Rosie, how to frame null hypothesis? Generally, it's very simple. Rosie, I'll again let you know how to frame null hypothesis. Generally, in the null hypothesis, we write like this way in the T statistic, there is no significant difference. You can write like this way also, very simple. There is no significant difference means null hypothesis, and there is significant difference means your alternate hypothesis. So the first one is the null hypothesis and second one is the alternate hypothesis. But in the statistical form, we write like null hypothesis is equal to, whereas in the statistically null hypothesis, we write is not equal to. Okay. So in the, you know, this is very difference that if I have a marker or board now, then things would be more comfortable when we do a in-person FDP. So from online, okay, you can just, I hope you got the, like, for example, in this particular example, I have taken that the mean length of the bolt is 4 inches. It means that there is no significant difference. Directional hypothesis, Harshdeep, you can take from the model. Harshdeep, directional hypothesis, you will take from the model your conceptual model, or you are taking from the review of literature. Your review of literature, from the review of literature, you will frame the directional hypothesis from the review of literature. And your arrows, which is denoting to one from the one variable to another variable, okay, that will actually they are actually the hypothesis. Okay, yes, very good question, Ashu. Okay, when we found that data are not normally distributed, then what to do? Apply one t-test or not? Fantastic question. So in this particular case, if you have the suppose if there is no normality, okay, if there is no normality, then you can go for the non-parametric test. What is non-parametric test? Just let you know. Just a moment, Amandeep. I'm just showing you. Yeah. Good question. Very good question. Okay. Suppose if the data is not normally distributed, then what should we do? Then what we can do here, we can go, in case of one sample, we can go for KS test, or we can also go for binomial test. Dekho, मैंने आपको ना मैं ये स्लाइड सारी शेयर करूंगा आपके साथ. आई विल शेयर दी स्लाइड्स टू ऑल ऑफ यू. डेफिनेटली दिस रिसोर्स इज योर रिसोर्स. ओके, आई एम पुटिंग माय हार्ड एफर्ट्स टू मेक इट सो यू कैन कंपेयर इट. देखो, प्लीज ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट एंड नॉन पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट. इन द पैरामीट्रिक टेस्ट, इफ देर इज वन सैंपल टी टेस्ट, इफ सपोज द पैरामीटर इज नॉट मेट, नॉर्मैलिटी इज नॉट देयर, देन यू कैन डू अ सब्स्टिट्यूट. व्हाट इज दैट सब्स्टिट्यूट? यू कैन गो फॉर chi-square, you can go for runs test, you can go for binomial test, you can go for KS test. Okay, in case of independent sample, I have just told you one example. Just say, for example, there is one class and I would likely to compare the average package of the student is same or different. Okay, so here I can go for the independent sample t-test, because I have the two distinct categories, that is girls and boys, and I'm comparing their average package. So if my data is normally distributed, I can go for independent sample t-test. But in case my normality is not met, then I have the substitute, which I can go for Mann-Whitney u-test. I can go for the substitute, which is called the Mann-Whitney u-test. Mann-Whitney u-test is a non-parametric test, which can I apply as a substitute for the independent sample t-test. Okay, so this is very, very important that today we have done the one sample t-test. And one thing you please important to note, that whenever you are going for parametric test or non-parametric test, always first check the assumptions. Without assumptions, do not go for parametric test. And you can see here also, this slide will be very, very important for you, dear student. When you have the univariate means single variable. Uni means one. Like I have shown you the example of Bolt. I have shown you the example of the library, satisfaction survey of library. Okay, so here you have only the one variable. Okay, that is, you are going to compare that variable and with the population mean. Okay, so here you can go for the one sample t-test. But in case you have the two variables, bivariate means that in case your independent variable is categorical, like boys and girls, males and females, non-metric, and your dependent variable is metric means like satisfaction, the difference in the satisfaction between the boys and girls, okay, then you can go for hypothesis testing. And here you can go for independent sample t-test and one-way ANOVA. Here this particular box will come, the hypothesis testing will come, that is the independent sample t-test and one-way ANOVA will come here. Okay, so first, today we have just completed this one sample t-test, when you have only the one univariate analysis and you have the data is metric data. Let me just a moment. Okay, so in the chat box, if normality, if two tail is when hypothesis has no effect, okay. And if P is high, accept the who. Yes, generally, when you write accept the, you write like this, that we fails to reject the null hypothesis. We fails to reject the null hypothesis. So I think, let me take your... So don't get confused with the one tail and two tail, please. One tail, when you are going to see the above or less than, below or above, okay, you are comparing with above average or below average, that is one tail. And when you are going to use the both, you know, above and below, then you are going to go for the two tail. So don't get confused in the one tail and two tail. That more important is that you should be clear that where do we apply the parametric test and where do we go for one sample t-test. In which of the conditions do we apply one sample t-test? So one thing is very clear, that one sample t-test is a univariate test. And you are going to apply the one sample t-test when you are going to examine whether a sample belongs to a particular population. Okay, that's very, very important. And you frame, you know, there are certain assumptions, which is very, very important. The assumptions are normality, number one. Number two, your data scale should be interval or ratio type. And third is that you should have the, you know, hypothesized value. Hypothesized value means the population mean. Please note down. Hypothesized value means population mean, population parameter. Just write down, because these are some terminologies which are used by the statisticians. Okay, and you should know. And for the normal distribution, you can numerically, you can check through KS1 sample test. KS1 sample test, yes. Either also you can do this way also. Main aapko ek aur tarika aur batata hun. Very short way of checking the normality. If you feel that this is quite good, then you can go through that way also. Like go to analyze, and in analyze, go to one legacy dialogue. In the legacy dialogue, you can do here one sample KS. In the one sample KS, just click on the length of, and then just click on OK. Even this is also the right way. Even means even in order to check the normality, you can also perform like this way. Go to analyze, non-parametric, and legacy dialogue, and one sample KS. One sample KS. This procedure is also right to check the normality. Otherwise, this procedure is also right, that go to descriptive and go to explore and click on the, pick the dependent list. And dependent list should be always be ratio or interval data only. Don't take the categorical data here, please, because you know that one sample t-test cannot be applied on nominal data or ordinal data. This is very, very important that you should know it, and you should be very careful while performing. So either you can go to analyze, non-parametric, legacy dialogue, one sample KS, and okay. So one and the same thing, if the results would remain be the same. Okay, you will get the KS value 0.200. Even I can show you this way also. Yeah. Right. So both sided means two tail. Yes, absolutely right. When you draw a normality, normal distribution, bell curve shape, the both sides determine the two tail. So this is 0.200, same value, same thing which we have done through the another way of getting the KS test. It is called the one sample Kolmogorov-Smirnov test, which is used to check the normality of the data, normal distribution. Okay. Then most importantly, data scale should be interval or ratio, and population parameter should be there. Hypothesized value. Otherwise, SPSS means your test value. That is very, very important when you are going to perform the one sample t-test. So you need a hypothesized value. And so now you know, I hope it is clear to you that what is one sample t-test, where do we apply one sample t-test. And just a moment, I'll give you one copy here. Let me just give me time. I'll write here the steps to you. Yes. please. I think copy paste is not possible. All right. Chaliye, anyway. Yeah, sir, yes, Amandeep. Amandeep Kaur. Why it is called bell-shaped? Okay, good question. Can anybody tell me that why it is bell-shaped? Why the normal distribution curve is bell-shaped? What is the reason? What is the reason that why it is bell-shaped? Why the curve is in the bell shape? Can anybody tell me that why it is called the bell curve? Bell curve is symmetrical. Bell curve is symmetrical. It means that your half of the data, it is taking a shape of bell curve, Amandeep, but the reason being because your majority of the data falls into the left to the mean and half fall to the right. And when you draw a histogram, it will take the shape of the normality. It will take the shape of the bell curve. That is why it is called a bell curve. And bell curve shape denotes the normal distribution. Normal distribution. It is just a graph actually, which actually depicts a normal distribution. And when it is symmetrical and when it is normal, actually it consists of a bell-shaped curve. And that is why, it is a common feature of the normal distribution. And that's why it is called a bell curve. Bell curve. It is a bell shape. The mean, median, and, you can say they all are equal. Okay. It has a bell shape. And that is why majority of the data, 68% of the data that falls between the one standard deviation to that is why it is the called as a normal distribution. Normal distribution. So 68% of the data falls within one standard deviation of the mean, and 95% of the data falls within the two standard deviation of the mean. If you go through the statistics books, please go through the statistics, you'll come to know. And that is why, and moreover, it is a symmetric bell shape. So that is why it is called the normal, we call it is a bell-shaped curve. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Exactly. True. So I think, I hope the one sample t-test is clear to you. Now I'm going to share today's PPT. This PPT I will share with you, and one exercise I will share with you. Tomorrow you will bring, there is one exercise I'm giving to you, whether you are from the education department, whether you are from the psychology department, or you are from the marketing department, or you are from the finance department, you have to bring one new problem on the one sample t-test. Read the papers. Please go through the research papers where the researchers have applied the one sample t-test. Why they have applied one sample t-test? For what reasons they have applied one sample t-test? That's what I would like you to know from you in the first 10 minutes. I will ask from you, okay, tell me any problem where you can go for one sample t-test. Okay. So I think this is enough sufficient for today. So you can have a cup of tea after this session virtually. Okay. Thank you. And I would also take. Okay, Ji, thank you. Over to you.
Good morning. Good evening to all. On behalf of Research and IPR Cell Khalsa College, Patiala, I would like Dr. Pavan Kumar for enlightening us a great knowledge regarding one sample test, how to apply one sample t-test. Sir, your today's lecture was full of awareness. Thank you, sir, for your efforts.
Komal ma'am, I'll share one research paper and I will share PPT so that the researchers could come to know why t-test is applied, why in which of the problem one sample t-test is applied, so that they should come and bring a new question, new frame, a new problem tomorrow. All right. So thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot.